I'm really excited about this event for two reasons. One, because I think the topic is extremely interesting and timely, and we've got a terrific panel. But secondly, because this is my first time to have an event in our new ballroom. And I'm very first, and although there have been, I think, one other event before this I wasn't able to come to. But so I'm sure it's your first time, too. For those of you who don't know, this is not our permanent building. This is swing space for the Middle East Institute. We're renting this from SOCAR. While our building, which is right behind us in the alley, that way, is being renovated. So we'll start with sledgehammers and tear down walls shortly. And then in 2 years, we'll be having this event again, talking about energy in the Gulf again, because I'm sure it'll still be an issue in a totally renovated Middle East Institute. So I hope you will track our progress over the next couple of years, because it's really, really very exciting. The event today will be followed shortly by an arts and culture program tomorrow at lunch. If any of you like to eat, and I can see several of you do, we're having a program tomorrow on food from the region. I think it's Syrian, isn't it, specifically? But it's part of our arts and culture program, and we believe that a lot of expressions of a people come out in their foods, and certainly pride from different cultures come out in food. So we're having a food event tomorrow, food from the Middle East, and you're all welcome to come to that too, and of course, something to eat as well. And then on Friday, there's yet another event on Palestine, isn't it, Mark? Yeah. Next generation of Palestinian leaders. So we'll have three events right in a row. Hope you'll come to all three, but we're delighted that you're here today. And then the third reason why I'm very excited about this panel is that our moderators, a dear friend of mine, Molly Williamson, and I were in the Foreign Service when we were children. And she has had a terrific career. She led our embassy in Bahrain. She led our consulate in Jerusalem. And she was a senior officer, seconded to the Defense Department, Commerce Department, and relevant to this panel discussion, energy. Molly knows everything, and she will introduce a very distinguished panel that we have today to discuss energy. So, Molly, over to you.
Programs, and I'm proud to be associated with them. Let me just start with a quick word about the order of magnitude. What are we talking about here? Because this is a very complex series of topics with lots of moving parts, lots of nuances, lots of interrelationships. Let's start with the fact that today, every single day, this planet consumes 96 million barrels of oil. It is the single most energy-dense substance, and the projections are that this planet will continue to use fossil fuels, which by definition are always coal, oil, and natural gas, for as far as the eye can see, well into the second half of this century. So use is up and growing worldwide. And so long as the planet is going to grow in population, and my mother explained to me that at least some of the 7 billion people on this planet are going to make babies. Some are already trying even as we speak. And we are so certain of this that the projections are that the planet will have 9.3 or 4 billion people by mid-century, and they are going to need energy. The second element that is so powerful is development. It is in the interest of this planet that as many people as possible have access to clean water, clean air, energy, opportunities for health, for education, and the chance to participate in the global economy. not to do so is also, it is not in the interest of the planet to have runaway disease, poverty, and a sense of hopelessness. That is the path to chaos. What this means is that for development to occur, there will be a growing need for energy to fuel that growth. So if we're lucky, there's going to be growth, and that means we're going to have to come up with ever more energy. The top three oil-producing countries in the world are Russia, Saudi Arabia, and the United States. That's a powerful combination. The three together produce almost a third of that 95 million barrels of oil a day. Anything goes wrong with any one of them, everything is affected. Of the conventional fossil fuels, and in particular oil and natural gas, it is important to keep in mind that 40% of all of the globally traded oil today comes from a part of the geography called the Middle East. Anything happens in the Middle East, the potential of impact for the planet's resource, the most precious commodities for energy, somebody's going to notice if 40% is infected, right? In addition, we have had an incredible revolution. One is a massive gas find in the eastern Mediterranean. And another is the revolution called the shale gale, primarily in the United States, and that has affected the structure of pricing and the movement, the band that's available for price manipulation and change. This is also a time in which, because the Middle East is facing so much of its own unrest, it is determined to varying degrees, but at long last, to develop, to diversify their economies, to grow their societies in order that the contagion of violence that's been sweeping this region since 2011 will abate. We need to buy time for these economies, and they are looking at, in their efforts to diversify, they are looking themselves at using more of their own commodities. More of their oil is being used, consumed by their own economies in order to diversify and grow. What we're looking at, therefore, is the emergence of a new oil order for the planet, and nobody quite knows what all that really means. But we are very, very lucky here at MEI today to bring you a panel of tremendous expertise. I am so proud to be sitting at this same panel with these wonderful folks, and they are going to address how the Middle East is adjusting to this incredible time of change and what that may mean for the planet. We start with the distinguished Justin Dargin, who has just come in from Oxford for our benefit. He may see other people, but we all know we're the real ones, right? You've got bios on all of our speakers here. What I would just point out is Justin has spent decades in this region. He has become well recognized globally as an expert at that intersection of the commodity, the energy sector, the global financial sector, both in terms of the state-owned oil companies and how the impact in the global economy has served. He has lived in the region. He has spent decades with the topic and developed expertise well recognized by the likes of Harvard and now Oxford. So we'll start with Justin, and then we'll go to Rauf, Brenda Shaffer, Jean-François, and what I want to do is introduce each just before they speak. So we'll start first with you, Justin. Welcome.
Great, thank you. Hello, everyone, and thank you, Molly, for the kind introduction. And it is a pleasure to be back at the Middle East Institute. Last time I was here was several years ago, so it's always a pleasure to be here. And of course, with the warm weather, so I quite appreciate all of your participation here. So what I would like to do is I'm going to discuss the MENA energy sector, and against the background, as we know, as Molly indicated, very dynamic, a lot of moving parts of a global energy sector, geopolitics, foreign policy, and what have you. Now, just to give a brief background of the MENA energy sector, of course, most of us, I think we know the figures. The MENA region, of course, has about 57% of the global oil reserves, and it also holds about 41% of global natural gas reserves. Now, if we look at the fact that it has quite enormous oil reserves, although at least in the Gulf region has relatively small populations, then the region exports the majority of its oil production. Now, if we hone in on the GCC, however, the picture becomes a bit more paradoxical. So the GCC, or the Arabian Gulf region, holds about 23% of global natural gas reserves. However, and this is wherein lies the paradox, it only produces about 8 to 10% of global natural gas production. So it's quite an issue, and indeed, this fundamental question undergirds the entirety, I would say, of my presentation today. Now, as the region has been attempting to industrialize and also to modernize its respective economies, some challenges, of course, have continued to pop up. And that main challenge is that of the utilization and the production of natural gas. And I think it's the natural gas molecule that is the fundamental, the most critical question, which informs nearly every single issue that at least the GCC region is facing at the moment in terms of sustainability, in terms of economic modernization, in terms of job growth for its youth, in terms of just nearly anything you can think of. I believe that's a natural gas molecule that is actually the most essential question to focus upon. Now, of course, this focus must be a bit broadened, of course, when we consider that there's quite a dynamic environment that's happening at the moment in terms of the energy sector and also more broadly geopolitics. And if we look at three main issues, of course, that's the growth in economic competition, hailing from the Asia-Pacific region. Of course, we also have, as Molly indicated, the shale gas and oil boom in North America, which imposes, I would say, has several different challenges that the region must grapple with going forward. And then we also, of course, have the collapse in the international oil price that occurred in late 2014. So if we consider that since the early 2000s, the MENA region has emerged as one of the highest energy-consuming regions. This is quite important. And it has only trailed India and China. Of course, both of the countries have considerably larger populations than the Gulf region. And of course, the Gulf region has, since the early 2000s, has continuously, year on year, by about 6 to 10%, increased its domestic energy consumption. Now, if we look at over the past 3 to 4 decades, we can see that gas demand across the entire MENA region has nearly doubled. And hence, we had natural gas deficits and also resultant power demand issues, blackouts and so on, that began to occur in the region about 2007, 2008, and 2009. And since then, many of the Gulf countries have been attempting, some ways better than others, but attempting to meet these challenges of ever-increasing natural gas deficits that have been rippling across the region. So the three critical challenges that I foresee and that I'm going to focus on during my talk are threefold. One is going to be looking at energy intensity in the region and the growth of energy intensity rates across the GCC. And also, which is related to this, is the rising natural gas consumption. And then lastly, how the countries in the region are going to be able to unlock their unconventional natural gas production. Now, what do I mean by unconventional natural gas production? Well, unconventional gas is natural gas which is more difficult to produce, and hence the cost of production is several-fold higher than what is considered to be easy natural gas. And easy natural gas is associated natural gas, that which is produced alongside of oil deposits. So going forward, most of the energy-rich MENA countries, in particular in the GCC, are focusing on the production of this more complicated gas going forward. And as a result, they're going to have to reconfigure their terms of investment in order to encourage a production of these unconventional gas reservoirs, and also reconfigure as well the domestic gas and power pricing framework inside of these countries as well in order to reduce consumption. So if we look at energy intensity, the first challenge that I indicated, now this has risen much more rapidly than any other region in the world, and nearly every single energy-rich MENA country has been attempting to industrialize along the energy-intensive industrialization path, and this has been occurring since the 2000s or so. Now, if we look at how this diversification and industrialization has been continuing apace, then we can see that there has been increasing energy intensity levels in the residential, industrial, and also in the commercial sectors across the board, and has been growing quite exponentially. Now, this growth of energy intensity has been harming the regional economic competitiveness, because we can see that one of the core strategies of the region has been to funnel or allocate a very low-cost, low-priced, inexpensive natural gas and power to these energies to give, to these industries to give them a head start and to be able to produce their products at quite a very low price, although unfortunately this is not able to hold going forward due to these allocation challenges that I indicated previously. So if we look at the rising energy intensity levels, as well as coupled, of course, with very low energy efficiency and these unsustainable natural gas consumption rates, then what we have are the energy deficits, which have been rippling across the gas and power sectors. And this has also had quite a corresponding effect as well in the industrial energy sectors as well. So there have been shortages in terms of many of the governments being able to allocate enough power and natural gas feedstocks to these industries. And also there has been a rise in environmental pollution, in particular if we look at that of carbon emissions, of course, which the GCC countries are going to have to deal with going forward, obviously post 2020. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, there has been a decline in economic competitiveness. And one of the only ways that this can be dealt with straightforward and quite significantly is, of course, to reconfigure the domestic natural gas and power pricing framework. Although at the same time, if this is reconfigured, then it's also going to harm the competitiveness, of course, of in these very industries that these countries are attempting to diversify and attempting to grow. So this, of course, is a type of essential paradox. It's because the countries at the moment are not able to produce enough incremental natural gas to be able to industrialize along the path that they desire. But again, the only solution that they have, of course, will reduce their economic competitiveness in these very industries. So, of course, that's an issue that many of the Gulf countries are grappling with at the moment. And, of course, one of the resolutions, I would say, to this problem would be to increase operational efficiency and also managerial techniques and know-how transfer and skill set transfer and so on and so forth. And that can be done. So instead of many of the countries fostering economic growth based upon low-cost feedstock across the board, indeed, they should be focusing rather upon operational efficiency. And I think that this would be one of the keys for these countries to be able to mitigate any type of reduction in economic competitiveness in these industries. The second challenge, of course, is that of rising gas demand. Now, rising gas demand in the aggregate is, of course, related to increasing energy intensity across the board, and the rise has been quite spectacular as well. So since the early 2000s, when there's been a focus on the growth in the downstream natural gas industries in the MENA energy-rich countries, the growth in natural gas consumption has been quite spectacular. And it has been growing about, you know, about 8 to 10%, we could say, on average per annum from about the year 2001, 2002 or so. Now, because the prices are significantly lower in the GCC region as compared to international prices, then what occurs is that an opportunity cost begins to develop. So as the countries have been diverting increasingly high amounts of natural gas to their domestic industry, as opposed to exporting at international prices, then of course an opportunity cost arises. Now, what intensifies this as well is that much of this natural gas has been diverted to the relatively non-productive residential sectors as opposed to the industrial sectors, where at least the countries will be able to acquire a bit of foreign revenue and so, and also be able to enhance the skill set transfer and so on, and technology transfer. But in terms of the residential sector, it does not add as much to the country's economic growth as it would if this natural gas were devoted to the various industrial sectors. Now, one other thing that can occur, and what we're starting to see at the moment, is a type of reshaping of the global LNG trade patterns as well. So one thing which is quite interesting is that the GCC has been considered to be the lead incremental natural gas supplying region going forward. Although when we had these dual impacts of the shale gas revolution in North America and then the gas allocation shortfalls in the GCC, the region is increasingly becoming a gas consuming region and indeed a gas importing region, which many thought scarcely even 10 years ago that this would even be quite possible. And even the fact that the U.S. Might potentially export LNG to the Gulf region, which is something which no one would have believed just even a decade ago. And then lastly, if we look at unlocking unconventional gas reserves. Now, in the region, the easy gas, of course, was associated natural gas, and this was a natural gas that the region had been banking on, so to speak, in terms of fueling their industrialization drive for the past several decades. Although, unfortunately, there have been allocation challenges at the moment because the increase in associated natural gas production is not able to meet the demand growth. So many of the countries have been looking at producing from these unconventional natural gas reservoirs, and many of them are standalone fields and so on and so forth. This also requires quite a high level of technical know-how to produce. Hence, many of the countries have been aligned with many international oil companies in order to transfer that expertise and so on and so forth. Although at the moment, the only way that the countries would be able to induce and to encourage and to stimulate investment of these fields is to reconfigure both the domestic natural gas pricing framework and also to reconfigure their prevalent terms of investment. And the terms of investment until now have been unfortunately a bit too low to encourage IOCs to delve into fully into production in many of these gas fields. So at the moment we are starting to see a type of change, a type of modification of the terms of investment in order to stimulate and incentivize IOC's interest in producing from these unconventional gas reserves. So just to summarize, because I think I might be running a bit low on time, so I'll be quite quick about it. Sometimes I can be a little bit verbose. It's that one of the impacts is that the resurgence of petrochemical the petrochemical industry in North America is going to threaten the diversification drive in the GCC. And I mean, the Gulf countries are attempting to deal with that at the moment. And if we also look at the fact that North America, and if we also include in Australia, could potentially add, well, if we just look at the US and Canada for the moment, could add potentially about 80 million tons of LNG on the global market in the next several years. And if we look at Australia, that could be a further 80 million tons of LNG. So going forward, it appears that the market is going to be a bit deluged with LNG, which of course could have a concordant impact on global LNG pricing, perhaps could even drop by about 30 to 40% or so. And this would have an impact on the MENA countries that are exporting liquefied natural gas, but most likely would have much more of an impact on Qatar, because if we look at most of the LNG exporting countries in the region, such as Egypt, if we also look at Oman and also the UAE, it appears that they are going, once their LNG contracts expire, many of them at the end of this decade, they are going to redirect that natural gas to the domestic industries and perhaps no longer be LNG exporting countries, at least for the interim. And then lastly, we do have the issue of still reverberations of the Arab Spring and related socio-political problems that relate to that. If we look at, in particular with North Africa, the cost of production might increase slightly because of security concerns in terms of, as we know, related problems with certain types of militant groups that are active in North Africa in particular. And that is more or less it, and I leave the floor to the rest of the speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Justin. The next speaker is Rauf Mammadov, who has joined MEI as a resident scholar on energy policy in the Middle East. His own history of expertise and association with the National Oil Company of Azerbaijan has given him that very special perspective of looking at a post-Soviet emergence of not only the countries but the national oil companies to address the global marketplace. He has given research emphasis on the post-Soviet countries of Eurasia and has held top administrative positions for SOCAR, the Azerbaijan State Oil Company. So we're very, very lucky to have him talk about the particular focus of Russian behavior post-Soviet exploration and mischief and opportunity, as well as constraints, as we look at the impact on the global energy scene. Rauf?
First of all, I would like to thank MEI for accepting me to their family. And also, it's an honor to share the panel with such distinguished panelists. What I will do is, describe the overall situation in the energy industry, in oil and gas industry, and then I will touch the energy policy of the current administration, which has been on the White House page website, and then I will dwell on how this energy policy of the new administration might affect the dynamics of relations between Europe and Russia, and I will give more background information about what's the current situation is between Europe and Russia. Well, it's exciting time for oil and gas industry. The industry itself is going through a transformation, as it has already been mentioned here. Several major developments are taking place. First of all, the balance of power is shifting from the OPEC towards non-OPEC countries. It's already been mentioned here that Russia and United States are becoming more prominent oil and gas producers. At the same time, the globalization of commodities are continuing. Oil is already a global energy commodity. Gas and natural gas, NGLs, and are becoming more global at the moment. So it will be interesting to see how the current administration's energy policy will fit in within this, you know, interplay of this of these developments. If you look at the energy policy itself, it's called America First policy. It's a little bit in a broad terms. It does say that it will create new jobs in oil and gas industry, as in other industries. It will deregulate the oil and gas industry. It will create provide an access for more federal lands to be accessible for production of oil and gas, but still unclear how will that impact the overall oil and gas industry. Will the United States, since becoming one of the major oil and gas producers, will it use its energy power to leverage its foreign policy goals? But one way or another, it will have repercussions in the industry, as you know, industry is becoming more global. Bottom line is it's too early at the moment to make a forecast whether how the impacts will be, but there is an uncertainty in the policy, and that uncertainty is of course creating ambiguity amongst both allies and rivals. Russia, on the other hand, is not wasting any time by trying to exert her influence in energy sector. The OPEC deal, the recent OPEC deal, Russia played a significant role. It was covered in the media. President Putin himself and Energy Minister Novak were engaged in the negotiation process. And Russia has made an announcement that they will make 300,000 barrels cut, which is actually half of the non-OPEC volume cut, which is almost equal to 558,000. That was a huge contribution to the deal. And by doing that, Russia, first of all, guaranteed that the oil prices will be stable. For oil producing and oil exporting countries, not only the high oil prices, but the stable oil prices are very important in terms of the future investments. Most of the gas contracts of Gazprom are linked to oil prices, so that creates a comfort as well. And from the political side, Russia is again emphasizing their importance in every opportunity to revive their influence in the international issues, and especially in the Middle East region. As far as Europe concerns, which is the biggest importer of Russian gas, it's the energy consumption in Europe has decreased below 1990 level. But the fossil fuel still remains almost occupies 73% of the energy mix, and it does import 7% of its hydrocarbons from abroad. Coal continues to hold almost 20% of in the energy mix, and the domestic production in Europe is declining, especially from Groningen field in Netherlands. Europe is continuing its dependence on Russia. One third of the gas that is natural gas that is being imported to Europe is still coming from Russia. In terms of the energy union policy by European Union, the current status of it, well, the newest policy paper has been published. There are certain goals and requirements as made clear. But if you look, I'm not going to dive in and go into details, but if you look at it, most of the requirements to the member states will be valid after 2020, and there are still issues that will be challenged by the member states, as always, due to their domestic situation and the elections. As I said, gas production, domestic gas production in Europe is declining. Infrastructure problems, especially in South and Southeast and Central Europe. We all know what's happening in Ukraine. That has enormous impact in importing gas to Europe. Some countries in Europe are still depending on coal, like Albania, which is they're producing it and it's cheaper to rely on that. But probably the most problematic issue is a dependence on a single supplier, and the single supplier is Russia. Russia itself has its own plethora of problems. You know, Ukraine again is a transit, major transit for their exports to Europe. That situation hasn't been resolved yet. And understandably, Russia is trying to find the ways to get their gas to Europe. And that there are two options at the table which will enable them to bypass Ukraine in the positive scenario, which is Nord Stream 2 and Turk Stream pipeline. I will not go into details, but if these two pipelines are successfully implemented, Russia will be able to circumvent Ukraine in 3 or 4 years. But there's a big if, and that is that Russia has is facing huge challenges. First of all, in Brussels, Nord Stream 2 has to go through the approval process. And since, you know, recently Russia has, Gazprom has purchased all the shares in Nord Stream 2, it's 100% owned by Gazprom, it will face huge challenges in terms of third energy package, and, you know, Europe is insisting on unbundling and providing third-party access to the pipelines. But the resistance to the pipeline has been decreasing. Recently, the local government in Sweden has agreed to provide their ports for the construction of the pipeline. Germany has been facing the stiff opposition, but they've been defending the project since it will go through it. There's a huge opposition by Poland to the pipeline project, but what's important is when you read the new released European Commission's State of the Energy Union, it doesn't mention Nord Stream 2 at all. So there is still problems in terms of the consolidated approach towards the energy security of Europe. Another challenge is Gazprom facing is adapting to changing gas market. It was mentioned here, the price mechanisms, the price formats are changing from long-term oil-linked prices to spot-based prices. And that will be challenging for Russia to adapt to that because most of their gas that they are delivering are through the pipeline gas and their oil-linked prices. But they have, in different levels, Russia has made it clear that they are ready to adapt to the situation. When you look at the overall the situation, Gazprom is like a Saudi Arabia to the oil industry. They have almost 100 BCM surplus of gas that they can work with. You know, they're like a swing, you know, they say Saudi Arabia is a swing state in terms of the oil supplies. Gazprom is a swing company, I guess. And, you know, their strategy seems clear. They will try to protect their market share, and which will also contribute to decreasing the prices in the market. That will make the usually expensive LNG projects less feasible. What's important is the liquidity of the market in Europe. Short-term forecast is optimistic, as it was mentioned here. You know, United States is exporting more and more LNG. Australia is bringing LNG to the market. Qatar has been doing that for quite a long time, but there are some problems with it as well, especially in the United States. So the current behavior of this administration towards LNG exports will be also will play also a key role. You know, it goes through the LNG export approvals go through two institutions in FERC from and the Interior Department, and you know, the process of approval, it takes quite a long time. So if the administration is keen to facilitate the process, that might have a huge effect on overall liquidity of the market. But even United States or Australia deliver those LNG volumes to the market, there are some countries in Europe that will not be able to get it because they are landlocked countries. This is why the alternative pipeline projects are important. And one of the projects that are being implemented or being constructed is the Southern Gas Corridor. It will run from Azerbaijan, will deliver gas to Europe, to Italy. It's the only alternative pipeline project that will deliver gas from east to west. And the capacity of the pipeline is only 16 BCM, but what makes this pipeline is important is that it will not only bring volumes, but it will also provide an infrastructure which Europe actually lacks. And then if there is an opportunity, then the other sources such as Turkmenistan, East Med, and other countries can join the pipeline. So if you sum up, Europe has to diversify its supply route, it has to build its own infrastructure, and it's to secure the stable supplies. Russia has to solve its problems with Brussels and try to adapt to new market realities, and the United States has to continue its commitment to support energy security of Europe by diversifying its supply routes. I think success will depend how committed the United States is to supporting these initiatives in Europe, and how fast or will the current administration ease the approval processes for LNG or for other industries, and which will, as I said, make the market more liquid. That will be it.
Thank you very much, Rauf. An incredibly complex series of issues there. I'm grateful for your remarks on it. Our next speaker is Professor Barbara Shaffer. Her book on energy politics is used as university level courses in over 200 classes around the globe. She is a recognized and world-renowned expert. Since the incredible discovery of a massive gas find in the Eastern Med, she has also been brought in to serve as a key advisor to Israel's prime minister in looking at the sort of miracle of abundance that suddenly befell Israel. And she has been frequently consulted by international regional organizations, NATO, and the like. We are very, very lucky to have Professor Shaffer with us today.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Well, if the 19th century was the era of coal and the 20th century was the era of oil, it's clear from this panel that the 21st century is the era of natural gas. Well, that will have, that's due to the discovery of a number of new sources of natural gas and new volumes in existing production areas, the East Med being among them. Well, that will have a lot of good impact in terms of climate and environmental, but of course, the sale of natural gas, as alluded to by Mr. Mammadov, is also much more complicated. It's much more political because, in general, it still takes place either through permanent infrastructure and/or through long-term contracts. So, what's going to keep people like yourselves in business for a long time? I think the era of gas will need a lot more consultants and people who understand the geopolitics of energy much more than oil, which has become much more of a commercial transaction. So, one of the big questions about this is what will be the nature of the trade of gas? Will it be look like oil? Would it be very commercial, mainly through traders with spot contracts, or will it be more in its traditional mode of long-term contracts, permanent infrastructure? And I think the jury is still really out on this issue, and it's important that we don't jump the gun to the sort of the enthusiast that this is going to be a global market, because what we're seeing so far is actually it's not jumping as fast to a global market. Trade between different regions is having ripple effects, but it still is not having a tsunami effect in terms of the nature of trade. And I think it's very important, for instance, if you look at, there's a lot of expectations, with the Trump administration, that he's going to allow a lot more export of natural gas, there's going to be a lot less restrictions on this. But we have to remember the reality is that even the gas that's been permitted so far from by the previous administration still hasn't found contracts for all of that gas. So there really is not a political issue of, let's speed up those permits, let's stop the environmental issues. There's really not even enough market out there for the gas. One of the more interesting reactions to the so-called global gas market is actually I saw recently that Lithuania, who had sort of built its whole energy strategy and independence on its LNG facility and bringing in U.S. imports, is actually renegotiating a contract with Gazprom because the LNG is too expensive. So until there's a dramatic change in the price of LNG or the gap of price between pipeline gas and LNG, I think the market is not going to stay as global. And in fact, new sources like the East Med new sources of gas that we found in Africa, for instance, actually give pipeline options to places that in the past could only think of LNG options. So first conclusions, we have to really think about, you know, which to understand how these new gas sources fit into the market, whether it's U.S. LNG, whether it's East Med gas, what will be the nature of trade, and again, the jury is still out. Well, when we think of MENA, we think of an energy-rich region. But when I think of MENA, I think of an electricity-poor region, right? So you have, Dr. Dargin pointed out in his presentation, you know, you have these great resources, right, but very little utilization in the region itself. And so we have two patterns. Let's say you have adequate supply in the GCC countries in terms of the hours of power, but yet often produced by oil, which is very expensive and polluting, or you have the model in the East Med. By the way, when I was growing up in America, I always understood I was Jewish. When I moved to Israel, I understood I'm American. Now I figured out I'm in the East Mediterranean. New identity. but anyway, personal points aside. In the East Med part of the Middle East, and you have completely erratic power supply. Blackouts are not a common thing, and in this part of the region where, you know, even agriculture is dependent on power supplies for water pumps, you can't think of any sort of stability in a place like Jordan, Egypt, Lebanon, eventually Syria, right, if you don't get the electricity piece down. So first thing, these new gas supplies in the East Med, they do give an option for improving electricity in the region, and connected to that is also improving water supplies in the region, because if you have natural gas you're a sea butter, you basically have an option of clean and relatively cheap desalination. So if I'm sure this institute had hundreds of conferences on water issues in the Middle East, essentially you can solve those conflicts basically through the natural gas resources, through proper utilization. Well, one of the, you know, there is great expectations that the gas resources in the East Med will solve all the region's problems. You know, suddenly you have gas and you're going to have reunification of Cyprus, you're going to have peace between Israelis and Palestinians. I never understood the exact connection between, you know, holy site resolution of issues and natural gas supplies, right? But so I think, you know, and I think it's we should think of pipe not as peace pipelines that they bring peace, but pipelines actually reflect relations. And more better than an audience like yourselves who are GCC experts, if you want a sort of a physical manifestation of how ununified the region is the fact that, as Justin pointed out, that there's very little gas trade in the GCC region itself, right? So, I mean, you would think on an economic basis would be much more logical that about 10 years ago when Kuwait built a regas facility and sort of importing LNG to figure out a way of a pipeline from Qatar through Saudi Arabia to Kuwait. But in terms of energy security, it decided it was much better to have the flexibility of LNG, right? Or even, you know, lack of a gas pipeline between Iran and Iraq, you know, thinking of this for decades, talking about it, this still that extra, you know, 400 meters across the border, you know, has not been built. So I think that you know, we should have very low expectations about how these resources, the type of peace they can create, because again, it doesn't even create commercial gas trade in the GCC, let alone peace, you know, between Palestinians and Israelis. And I think that realism is taking a much bigger hold in the region. If there's this great euphoria about what these resources could do, I think there is a lot more realism. Probably today, on both the Israeli government and the Turkish governments, for instance, are very keen on establishing a gas pipeline trade between Turkey and Israel. But I think, at least especially from the Turkish side, I think Turkey sees this more as a commercial venture that actually this could help lower its gas prices at home, and it could build infrastructure in the southeast of Turkey, less in terms of political. Maybe on the Israeli company side, I think they have some political goals of being linked to Turkey, but I think they're pretty sober about, you know, it can go both ways. When you have commerce and infrastructure, it could reinforce peace, but it also could become actually, you know, it's actually the supplier can be dependent on the market for payment. I think that one thing that's very interesting is we never learn any of the economic lessons. You know, if you ask anyone sitting in the room from the World Bank, IMF, you know, are low energy prices a good thing? you know, other way of calling that energy subsidies. It'll tell it's the worst, you know, worst distortion. It creates lower energy efficiency. But you see the peoples of, whether it's in Israel and Cyprus, what they're really hoping that these resources will bring them low energy prices and they can just pollute away, you know, and have a lot of traffic and all these things. That So hopefully still pushing that, you know, for more rational pricing of these resources as well. It's also very interesting that, as I concur with Rose's point about the significance of Russian OPEC cooperation on the recent price cut slash freeze. Let's remember, this is unprecedented. You know, for years, Russia and the Soviet Union, and then Russia and OPEC have danced around cooperation, and the fact that it took place, I think this is a highly significant event. And I think we could have learned a lot about Russia's interests in Syria, and even I think people who looked at Russia's energy interest in the East Med could have anticipated. Oh, I think there was someone who did. Okay, but could have anticipated Russia's expansion of its deployment, military deployment in Syria. Because if you think of Russia as a Middle East power, you don't. It's not a. You know, you don't think of it as a highly influential power. But when you look at Russia and the East Med, and if that includes Italy, Greece, Cyprus, Turkey, Israel, Syria, then you understand this is a crucial region for Russia, both a major point of its oil exports, a player of its companies in energy, in gas and oil exploration. Its fleet reaches the East Med more than the British and the American fleet, so you could understand why Syria was not just some sort of, you know, it wasn't Vanuatu for it was for the Soviet base. And why they would be there. And I think we're going to see much more Russian involvement in the energy sectors, whether it's in Egypt, Israel as well. It's probably will, with the divestments going there, will make a play. Syria post-stabilization has incredible geological promise. Its gas production was going up right before the Civil War, and probably you will see more of that. So I will just conclude with a negative note to keep it, you know. That I think that what another development in the region that's going to happen in the energy and energy front is with probably anticipated dislodging of militants, Daesh, ISIS militants from Iraq and Syria. They're going to look for a new home. I think that's going to be North Africa. And if I was a gas consumer in Southern Europe, having gas from Algeria, from Libya, I would be very nervous. For the oil market, if you had, you know, two million barrels a day from Libya, a million from Algeria, go offline, everything that everyone's enjoying, these low oil prices would change. So I think the next big nasty spot challenge for energy is going to be North Africa. So have a nice day.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara. You got the bio on Jean-François Seznec. He has been a recognized expert at the intersection of international finance and energy policies and energy industries for some time. But what you may not know is that his expertise is so far-reaching that the Saudis asked him to brief them, to brief Saudi Aramco on their Vision 2030. So they all have an interest in getting his expertise. Aren't we lucky that he is also an MEI scholar? Jean-François?
Thank you very much. This is a very difficult assignment because I've been asked to talk about something I don't really know much about, which is, and nobody knows much about, is the policy of the U.S. administration in the near future. This is quite interesting because maybe I'll make three points if I can, is that at this point, because of the development of shale oil in this country, in the past few years, really we're having in a situation where we have a changing pricing structure in the world. And that will basically maintain, and I'm going out of my way on this, prices below $60 a barrel, maybe between 50 and 60. The other point I will make is that this rather low income for the producers in the Gulf, in the GCC producer, and especially Saudi Arabia, is that it will force them to achieve modernization of their economy and their politics. And I think what we're seeing with Vision 2030 is exactly that. It's a modernization of the economy to move away from oil, which is nothing new there. They wanted to do this since 1970, but now it's really on steroid. And we may see that followed by a change in governmental structure. The final point I will make in passing, since we've talked a lot about gas, and I totally agree that it is the fuel of the 21st century, but it's going to put an enormous amount of pressure on Qatar in terms of income. So let me start with the pricing structure here and the shale oil and gas developments. We have heard everywhere that the administration will ease the regulations on drilling in the region in the U.S., which will basically mean that there will be more fracking and that shale oil will become increasingly important. We now produce about 5 million barrels a day of shale oil, and that is quite a large amount. The part of the regulations also will be to have new pipelines, and as you know, the Dakota pipeline is going to go through very shortly. There's the pipeline which is bringing oil from Canada down to the south. It's also going to be probably approved in due course, although it might take a couple of years to really get going. But basically what will happen is that the U.S. will start producing enough crude to start exporting. Now, I don't want you to believe that the U.S. is going to become a major exporter of oil. The U.S. to this day still imports 10 million barrels of oil a day. Now, they re-export a lot of products because we have a lot of refineries, but net, we still import over 4.5 million barrels a day. And before we cover these 4.5 million total, it will be a number of years, even with shale oil going. But, 10.5 million barrels a day of net import matters on the markets quite substantially. Now, we also import today among these 10 million barrels, we import 2.5 million barrels of products, and we export almost 5 million barrels a day of products as well. So it's quite a mixed bag in the U.S. We now have, I believe Congress has approved the export of oil, which was totally forbidden for generations. And now, the exports of crude oil have been up to 1 million barrels a day, when it was way below 400,000 barrels before. So we already spiked at 1 million barrels a day today. We are also exporting LNG. There are a lot of problems with getting the permits, but that is something that may change with this new administration, maybe. Mm-hmm. But the fact is we are exporting on an annual basis. Cheniere, who is the only manufacturer and producer and exporter today, is exporting, has a capacity to export 12 million tons of LNG per year today. So this matters quite a bit. I think perhaps what's quite interesting to see is that the change, which I'm really pointing out, is the fact that at $50 to $60 barrel per barrel, the producers can get in the market very quickly. And there's more drilling taking place now than there was last year. The companies are producing more than they were last year. And the structural difference is that the shale producers, especially in the oil side, can go back to the market in 30 days. If they have shuttered down their plants, their wells, because the prices were too low at 30 or 40, they can get back into the market at 50. And do that in 30 days, and that matters, and they're doing it as we speak. If they start from scratch with a new well, they can produce within 90 days. And that's really changing the whole atmosphere, because in the past, if the Saudis decided to develop a new oil field, or ExxonMobil found a new oil field somewhere, we don't know where Exxon finds them these days, but it would take up to 5 years to get the field going. Now we can do it in 90 days. So it's really changing the whole structure of the pricing. In other words, At $60 per barrel, we're going to see more oil coming onto the market very quickly, and we are seeing it as we speak. So that means the fundamental economic 101 review of oil was that oil is an inelastic commodity. You cut production, and the prices, your revenues go up more than what you lose in cutting the production. And that's what the Saudis were trying to achieve with the Russians. And they know about these problems of the shale. They're very, very sophisticated, but they figured if they can do it very quickly, that will bring up the market to 50, 60, and that will basically guarantee a certain level of income. But they know that the price will stay at this level, because if it goes up any higher, there'll be a lot more drilling of and a lot more production in the United States, which will translate into declining prices. So they know they have to do that. And that really creates some really very interesting situation, because once the producers know that the prices are pretty stable at 50 to 60, it means that they're going to have to really make some very important decisions. The Saudis in particular know that they will have a deficit this year. They'll have a budget at $50 a barrel. That's a total income of about $175 billion, and they have expenditures of $230, maybe $175 million if it goes to $55. They still have a major deficit. Cash deficit. So where does that money come from? Well, it comes, they do have $500 billion in the bank, well, mostly in U.S. treasuries here in Washington, but they're borrowing money on the world market to show their capacity to borrow. They've borrowed $17.5 billion from the banks a few weeks ago. They're going to go back to the market for another $10 billion. But basically, it means that it forces them, and it's really a blessing for the Saudis to have lower income. It forces them to restructure their economy. It forces them to be successful on this Vision 2030 that they've been promoting actively. And it is not a given, because there's a lot of opposition within Saudi Arabia on Vision 2030 and the changes in government, the National Transformation Plan. So. Having a relatively low income gives them an argument to force the modernization of the state. And I think that's really quite interesting. At least I find it's quite interesting. So the shale oil revolution is really having a big impact, not only in this country, where we're going to increase our exports, as I mentioned, but also on the producers today. I don't know about Russia, some other, you know, but certainly in Saudi Arabia, it means more modernization, going away from oil. Now, they've been trying to get away from oil since 1975, but their big problem was the price was going through the roof. And it's very nice to be able to make money, and you know, to make money at 140 without suffering too much. So now they're really forced to do it, and we'll see how that develops. The one thing that is, of course, of some interest in terms of the gas issue is, to finish on this point on Qatar, is that Qatar today has the largest production of LNG in the world. It produces 77 million tons. They're producing at capacity. Their main markets are Japan, Korea, and China. But they are getting blown out of the water by the other producers. And the main one, of course, is Australia. And today, Australia has become the largest supplier of natural gas to China, by far, and to Japan, and to Korea. So Qatar is still, you know, is beginning to hurt, because they're pretty far from those markets. And the price is sold for today. Qatari gas sells in Japan at $7.1 per million BTU, which is, you know, a fair amount of money, but it is CIF. In other words, it includes transport. And if you exclude transport and all the other costs into putting the gas on the ships and so on, the net back income to Qatar is only $4 a million BTU. And that corresponds to an income of $15 billion per year, which is really not that much money for a country that is going to host the football soccer tournament at $40 billion, a shot. Thank God they also produce 800,000 barrels of oil and another million barrels of natural gas liquids, you know, propane and butane, which gives them another $30 billion to play with. But still, it's very low for their needs. And then on top of it, we get the U.S. And the U.S. as producing up to 15 million tons per year today, and has plans, if they some of them come through, they'll go up to 100 million tons a year, just like Australia. And Qatar cannot go beyond its 77 million. So Qatar will become a third player and will have to sell, and as they are now, at a discount. And therefore, they're going to really get hurt. Now, this is really interesting because it means, basically, that it's going to change how the relationship between Qatar and the rest of the Gulf will be in the near future. I think somebody mentioned that there was a great deal of gas deficit in the region, and certainly Saudi Arabia does not in full deficit now, but if they continue on their pattern today, they will be have a deficit in natural gas. So where do they get their natural gas? Well, there are two sources for the Saudis, and they have to be low at low prices, otherwise it's not worth the effort for them. And that sources is Qatar, of course. But if Qatar is producing at capacity today, if they start selling gas to Saudi Arabia, they'll have to shut down some of their LNG lines, which is probably sooner or later going to have to happen. But at what price they sell to Saudi Arabia, I don't know. I mean, they need only 300 kilometers pipeline to put the gas through, and that's quite cheap. But there is a technical, there is a political issue between Qatar and Saudi Arabia. They could have done that a long time ago. The surprising thing to me is that if you look at the map, you'll see that the main gas field of Iran, which is the same gas field as Qatar, but just across the border, is actually closer to Saudi Arabia than it is to Iran. So you could really well imagine, and I use the word imagine, that Iran and Saudi Arabia could actually make a deal on Qatar where Iranian gas could go to Qatar using Saudi capital to build a pipeline, and in turn the Saudis could turn around and sell a lot of very advanced chemicals, which they make now, they're one of the most advanced in the world, and to Iran. So there is a possibility of exchange in that sense. So I'm not losing sleep or holding my breath to see this happen, but it is, let's say that there is a possibility of a deal if things started to improve. So I think the whole thing, though, is considering what's happening in the LNG and what's happening in Russia and the East Med, which is really fascinating to hear, is that their prices will still remain to the $3 to $4 range. And they are getting closer. There's no market worldwide, for sure. But the prices are getting a little closer. We're at $3.25, $3.50 here. And we see that Qatar only makes four, really, ultimately. And that if they have to sell to Saudi Arabia, they're going to have to sell at three. So I think we'll see not a world market, but more of a convergence of these various markets. Maybe I'll leave it at that.
Thank you so much, Jean-François. You can see how much change there is in this marketplace. It's phenomenal. We would not have guessed 10 years ago that this is the scene we would be facing for global energy. And we are looking at a lot of moving parts, trying to predict what will motivate Russian behavior in the course of the next 5 years, how that will be implemented throughout the region, trying to anticipate what the events of the Arab Spring, which has now lasted longer than all of World War II, how they will continue to play out, trying to anticipate the growth both of demand, but how to meet that demand, not only in terms of just is the supply available, but what is the infrastructure? How would we get it to marketplace? It's an extraordinary time. I'm going to open this up for questions for the audience now. We have some microphones available. I would ask you please identify yourself by name and affiliation if you're with a particular organization. And please leave your question in the form of a question as distinct from a long-standing comment, which we might prefer offline instead. Let's start over here, this man, and then come here to the front, shall we? Please.
Thomas Bonomo's Jazz Advisors. I wanted to ask the panelists about potential for Russian interference, political interference in Algeria in response to developing EU-Algeria relations on natural gas markets, as well as, if I could, how exactly Russia would respond over time to natural gas developments in the Mediterranean in general. Thank you.
Rauf, do you want to start with that, and then we'll see?
I will just mention the general pattern, and then I will leave the panelists to explain more. The general pattern of strategy of Russia is that, first of all, Algeria is one of the competitors of supplying gas to Europe versus Russia, and what Russia is usually doing is it's either when there's a competition, it's either trying to, for example, if there's a pipeline project, either trying to be part of the project or to build a parallel pipeline project that will actually supply gas to the same region, which will diminish the feasibility of that project. So I would assume that if there is any activity by Russia in Algeria, that will be the motivation of Russia is actually involving in that process.
Thank you. Justin, do you want to add a word, Jean-François?
Sure, I can just make two quick points. I mean, Russia has been pursuing, at least over the past several years, has been, on one hand, a focus on the Asian market, not necessarily to the exclusion, of course, of the very important EU market, but it has been developing much more deeper interest in the Asia-Pacific market in terms of gas export. And then also, Gazprom has also shown much more flexibility in terms of gas pricing as well, which it wasn't. It tended to be a bit more resistant to any type of flexibility on gas pricing, but indeed it has changed its tune over the past several years. So I think in that regard, at least if we look at structurally, then Russia is becoming much more flexible, I would say, and adaptable.
Jean-François, did you want to add a word, or Dr.?
Just very, very briefly. I think the whole notion of Algeria selling gas to Europe has existed for 30 years. They have three pipelines going from Algeria through one through Tunisia, one through Morocco, and one directly to Europe. They probably are not going to build a fourth pipeline. It's too expensive. So I think I'm not sure the Russians, it would be in their interest to try to interfere with that, but they might try to compete, as you mentioned. So.
Barbara, did you want to add a word?
Sure, yeah. I think it's important to point out that despite all the efforts in the EU, as Rauf pointed out, about the energy union and all the policy initiatives post-Ukraine crisis, that actually the proportion of Russian gas consumed in Europe has gone up since the last Ukraine crisis. So all these efforts so far have not brought any results. And the reality is that even though European gas consumption is in general going down, and in fact in many markets actually its coal consumption is going up, despite all its complaints about the United States and leaving Paris, whatever, U.S. emissions are going down while Europeans in 2014, 2015 went up. But because domestic gas production in Europe is declining, there's greater need for gas imports. So I think that Russia's strategy, it's not to compete everywhere, but it's to compete and undermine in specific markets. So I agree that Algeria has been a supplier for decades, and that again the problem might be, can it maintain those supplies, and not will it expand those supplies for a variety of reasons. And Russia's been comfortable with that, especially because most of the Algerian LNG or gas ends up in Spain, where it's not but if you try to compete in Bulgaria or Serbia. Or Hungary, I think you're going to have a very different Russian response than if it's in the western part of Europe. So I think a lot of it is about the, and then you can see, for instance, in the recent, I concur with Mr. Mammadov's evaluation of how, for instance, Russia uses a variety of tools. If you look, for instance, the recent announcement by the Alexei Miller about Gazprom maybe using TAP, the last portion of the Southern Gas Corridor into Europe. So again, it's not actually by taking over the pipeline or invading somewhere, but it's actually using EU rules on third-party access that actually give it a right to compete there. So very clever use right there, of the abuse use of those rules. So.
Thank you, Brenda. I'm sorry, I called you Barbara earlier.
It's a nice name, I don't mind.
No.
Barbara Streisand.
I called you Barbara by name. I think we had a question here for the microphone person.
Well, Zubairik Bala, the Middle East Institute. I'm a little bit more cynical and skeptical about things getting better in the GCC particularly. And I don't expect Saudi Arabia to make a big thing out of this vision, which is really more of a paper thing rather than a reality. But my more important issue is the following. We are focusing essentially on the crude oil and gas exports and imports. We are not looking at the possibility of establishing a market in electricity. Generation of electricity either in these countries which export oil and gas at this moment or elsewhere, and building a grid whereby a global market in electricity can be developed and therefore will be a market which is at a not a primary commodity level, but a secondary commodity level, which would clearly be more stable, number one. Number two, has much greater options of inputs that can go into it.
So the question is anybody thinking about an electricity market in the region?
I hope so.
Yes, absolutely. There has been the formation of the GCCIP, the interconnection grid, which came online several years ago. Yeah. And what it does, it exports electricity to the various electricity exchange amongst the various GCC countries. Now, at the moment, of course, the trade is not that extensive, but it still has a potential to. And as you correctly indicated, it's that electricity is not nearly as politicized as natural gas, which is one of the reasons why there has not been a development of a pan-GCC natural gas grid, even though the plans were on the table for decades. The countries tend to have no problem with exporting and importing electricity amongst themselves. But this has been in operation, though, for the past several years, the GCCIP.
Good. Okay, there was a question here.
No, it's just it's a GCC phenomenon at the moment.
Jason Pack, Executive Director at the U.S. Libya Business Association. Quick clarification, then a question. You mentioned 2 million barrels a day from Libya that might be cut off. The Libyans haven't produced over a million in since the revolution. We're only at about 600, 700,000 right now. And you know, even in 2018, I can't see getting 1 million a day. So that's the clarification. And my question is, it's so fascinating, of course, as you pointed out, that we're not talking about Hubbard peaks like 20 years ago. We're talking really about a glut. So pretend that you were a producing country, call it, say, Libya, and you had some intellectuals who got their PhDs in the West, and they're planning, once we get our act together and actually are stabilizing, how do we compete for market share? And they hire you, the panel, as some consultants, knowing that they're going to have to give pretty sweet terms because people are really scared that their supply is going to be cut off, or, you know, why take the Libyan gas or oil when we could deal with a better source. So what would be the advice as paid consultants that you would give to this hypothetical country competing for market share?
Justin, you want to start?
Well, sure, absolutely. Well, I mean, as we know at the moment, Libya is not necessarily beholden to the OPEC quotas. And I do believe, though, at least if we look at the general trajectory of Libyan production, that it has been increasing, and potentially by the end of 2017, that it might reach that perhaps somewhat mythical, but I think entirely possible, 1 million barrel mark. I think it's possible if you looked at least the trajectory that it has been going so far, and the fact that the government has reasserted control over all of the oil fields at the moment, although there still is the potential for, of course, Daesh activity, and also with the squabbling between the various governments that claim leadership of the country in the East and West, I mean, in particular, right? But I think, though, Libya is on a much better track than indeed it was even several years ago. So in terms of acquiring market share, I mean, I would say that that would not be necessarily the focus at the moment. I would say the focus at the moment should be merely on creating a sense of stability for domestic production, as Libya is not, of course, under any type of OPEC quota at the moment, because it got got an exemption because of course, it's social political issues. But I would say focusing on attempting to create a sense of security for international oil companies, of course, to operate there as well. At least the terms of investment, as you correctly stated, would perhaps be sweetened, of course, due to the risk premium involved. But I think that that would be the major focus at the moment, at least initially, as opposed to attempting to acquire global market share.
I think there was a question of,
Could I just begin?
Certainly,
Jean. I think perhaps the issue is not so much to bother about market share. I think what Libya may want to consider is go downstream, fully downstream. In other words, develop the refineries and use the products from the refineries to go into chemicals of various nature, just like the Saudis and the UAE and Qatar and even Oman to a certain extent has been doing. So you don't have to fight for market share at the lowest price. You can fight for market share on chemicals that have multiplied the value of your barrel of oil by 10, and you still have competition. And it's still very expensive. It requires huge investments. But that can be done with, you know, investments in joint venture with the Saudi firms, with the Kuwaiti firms, et cetera, et cetera. It doesn't have to just depend on the West. And I think that could be quite interesting.
Yes, there was a question over here in the front row.
Thank you very much. Michael Kurtzig, retired U.S. Department of Agriculture, worked on the economics and agriculture of the region. And one of the things that I'm very interested in is something Rauf mentioned, and maybe Justin, and that is employment and labor. Will this industry, the natural gas and oil to some extent, provide the jobs that are necessary in this region? Because there's very high unemployment, even in Saudi Arabia. What type of education, what kind of marketing what kind of training will they need in order to meet, supposedly, this expansion in the GNP? Thank you very much.
Okay. Do you want to start with this, Justin, and then Jean-François?
Sure. I mean, so a very good point that you made. Of course, obviously, the hydrocarbon industry is very capital intensive, not labor intensive. So that is an issue. Although, as I stated initially, and I think Jean-Paul would agree with me, it's that the natural gas molecule is the future of modernization and diversification in the region going forward. And not necessarily just in the sense of course, exporting natural gas or indeed even the petrochemical sector, but if you look at perhaps the creation of forward and backward linkages throughout the national economy, if the countries are able to do it correctly. So you can have the growth of various industries that could piggyback, if I were to use that term, on the back of quite extensive investment in the energy intensive industries, and also in terms of the petrochemical industry and so on. You can have a vibrant financial sector that could arise from that, and also various other industries, and even quite more industrially based industries. But it depends if the countries actually take the right path and again create forward and backward linkages throughout the entire national economy, then I think it could be entirely feasible.
Did you want to add to that, Jean-François, or Rauf, or?
I think this is what Justin mentioned is really right. I mean, the word is downstream, and to go as far downstream as you can. In terms of training, the Gulf countries already have huge training programs, and not just for training large intellectual brains, you know, but manual stuff. They have, you know, hundreds of schools for that. And they have a long ways to go still, and they have to bring the women in the workforce, which is really going to make a big change and stop relying on foreign workers. And once you have that, things will move very extensively. Of course, agriculture, unfortunately, is not where it's going to be created, but it can go into many different directions, as Justin pointed out. Right.
I think that's a very important point. It's very important for national oil companies of the countries that you've mentioned become more active in development of their resources. I know that the company that I work for, throughout its 20 years of existence, have gone through that transformation from becoming a passive partner in to major companies, and then trying to step up and then to become more active, actually expand its business, and that way you can train your your personnel, and you know they also have training programs, scholarship programs. Government of Azerbaijan has scholarship programs. That's the way. First of all, you have to integrate to the industry and to bring your staff as with you and to train them.
If I can make also just one very brief comment, it does require a revolution also, a revolution of mindset, because of course, as we know, that there has been a certain, internalized resistance towards working in certain jobs in the private sector that may not be considered as prestigious nor as perhaps not as labor intensive as certain jobs could be. And maybe, I won't get into this, but it could require the imposition of a notion of scarcity as well, which of course has worked to a certain effect in other countries.
We have time for one more question, one last question back here.
Thank you. I'm Javier Arbona from Lynn University. Thank you for the presentation. I have a two-part question for Ms. Dargin. The first part relates to the International Court of Arbitrations created a $1.9 billion fund in compensation to Turkey for Iranian overpriced natural gas. Do you have any comments on what that would mean for the future? And then also, Iran's currently moving to sell energy directly to Turkey. How do you feel that will change energy dependency in the region? Thank you.
Okay. Could you please repeat your last question? I didn't quite hear.
Iran is starting to sell electricity directly to Turkey, or in negotiations to do so. How do you believe that that will change the energy dependency in the region? Thank you.
Okay, sure.
Justin, and then Brenda.
Sure. Now, I haven't focused much on Turkey for my research, but I mean, I can say several things. In terms of your first question, of course, it's Iran has always been considered to be a somewhat of a difficult partner in terms of energy deals in the region. It has backpedaled on numerous agreements, even agreements that were conducted with the UAE. So I think that perhaps this particular arbitral award would make Iran less likely in the future to backpedal if it does have to pay a significant price for that. And of course, that could be quite figurative or literal price, as the case may be. And also, in terms of electricity export to Turkey, well, the thing that's interesting is that, as I indicated before, in terms of intra-regional electricity trade, at least in the GCC, electricity tends not to be nearly as politicized as the trade in hydrocarbons. So if we look at oil, if we look at natural gas, and to a lesser degree coal, which is not quite politicized, but the trade in electricity can exist somewhat freely without the accompanying baggage of various regional squabbles and so on. So if we look at the GCC, for instance, the GCC IP, the interconnection grid, has came off the ground and it's going quite swimmingly, as they say, so far, so good. Now, I think potentially that could be also the basis between Iran and Turkey in the future of further, let's say, economic and energy linkages between the country, which won't necessarily have as much politics wrapped around it as potentially oil or natural gas would have. That was my two cents on it.
Brenda, did you?
I just say the Turkish gas and electricity market, that, I mean, it's generally perceived as, you know, a growing market and you know, high rates of economic growth in the last decade and translated into high growth for electricity and for gas consumption, which is true. But on the other hand, I think it's actually a well-diversified and well-supplied a market, which gives actually Ankara a lot of leverage over its various suppliers. So again, when we think about, you know, I know you look at it from the Israeli perspective, they see this, you know, growing market, it'll be very easy to get into, but there's already four existing supply projects, gas supply projects into Turkey. A fifth, the Southern Gas Corridor that Rauf mentioned, by 2018 will be operational with gas arriving into Turkey. Potentially Turkish stream, you know, coming into Russia or Turkey, or most likely coming into Turkey. So being, you know, a sixth supplier, this is actually a really well diversified market. And so actually Turkey Ankara can set the terms with a lot of its suppliers. And I think that's, you know, part of, I think there'll be actually a a lessening of interest of imports for from Iran. As Justin pointed out, they're quite erratic, unreliable supplier. Also, the quality of the gas, which is very highly sulfur and has created a lot of cost for Turkey to use this gas. And again, with other options, whether it's the East Med, Iraqi Kurdistan, additional Russian gas, probably also Azerbaijani gas stage two. Once TANAP is built, it'll be very easy to develop additional supplies in Azerbaijan and bring those into Turkey. That's probably the most likely, you know, easy gas source. And in terms of, does Iranian electricity supplies create dependence? I think it's very important in every energy supply relationship to not assume that it's actually the supplier that has control over the consumer. Often it's the market that the supplier is more dependent on the revenues from the market than actually the market is dependent on the supply. So I think again, Turkey is much more diversified than it actually often, I think, in the rhetoric about the Turkish market appears.
Will you join me in appreciating the wonderful expertise we've had?